What I've learned lately is that a loss is more impactful than an actual win in regards to money specifically. We're talking life lessons. Sometimes a failure is the better lesson than a victory, than just winning the race. Sometimes it's the failure that actually helps somebody win the race, win the next challenge or whatever it is. But when it comes to money, if I have $10,000 and I invest it and I get 100% rate of return, so my money doubles, now I have 20,000, right? And then if I have a loss of 50%, that's $10,000. The number is smaller, right? The percentage, 50% loss. The first year was 100% gain. It went from 10 to 20 grand. But then in year two, I lost 50%, go from 20 back down to 10. If you were to do the average, that's an average rate of return of 25%, positive. That doesn't make any sense. You're back when you started. So that's where the numbers get a little tricky. And you're like, oh my God, like that doesn't, what just happened? What just occurred? The last thing we want in our 60s, late 50s, 70s, is any loss. Like we really do not want to be, you're better off not doing a particular investment if we don't have the confidence, we've done the research, we've got the skills, talents to actually make this happen. The last thing we want to do is be trusting our money with someone else. And I'll put myself on the hot seat, like even someone like myself. The last thing we want to be doing is just trusting any person with our money in the hopes that this policy, that this crypto, this gold, this stock is going to do anything for us. Let's think about what our skills are. How can we collaborate, partner with people in the marketplace to actually produce real gains, real income, not gains on paper, like real cash flow, real gains, especially in our 50s and 60s and 70s. We get to a point where now we've either cleared out all of our liabilities, we've got good positive cash flow, and we can afford to take a little risk because all of this is in line. If anything goes down, got that tax-free death benefit, covers, you know, all of my costs after death. I've got no debts on the books. I've got maybe two cash flowing assets, and I've got a lump sum of cash, in her case, maybe 40 grand, 50 grand, whatever it is. And I wanna try to put that to work in a safe environment, right? What can I do? Okay, so let's think on that. Let's have those discussions. Let's ask questions 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 times when we're working with people, whether it's a financial advisor, CPA, attorney, financial coach or consultant like myself, any type of investment advisor or strategist. Be asking multiple questions. Don't just fall in line, so to speak. Be very, you know, provide objections, right? And challenge what is being said here so that you don't get fooled, right? Because in her case, I don't know what she was thinking around age 58, 59. She probably came across some videos on the internet about infinite banking and spoke to one agent probably. And that one agent said, yep, you got to do it like this. Well, I'm like, what was the conversation? Did he go over your numbers? Did he ask you how much discretionary cash flow you've got, capital? Doesn't sound like any of that was a conversation. And in her case, she was just like, well, I was already saving 30, 40 grand a year, and I thought this would be a great savings tool. And I'm like, well, you've got that part, right? Yeah, it's a great alternative. The problem is it costs you an extremely a crazy amount of money to do it. And so now two, three years later, she's now seen, she came across my material. And I'm always, not only am I pro infinite banking, but I also challenge the same concept at the same time to get you guys to just not just fall in line, so to speak. Oh, this is so great and da da da. Like, no, let's really evaluate it. Why are we pushing this split over that? When does it make sense? When does it not, you know?